In my seventh grade, on a spring day deep in the Kentucky hills, aged and tremulous Sister Marie Therese assigned us to draw posters illustrating some important principle from our Roman Catholic catechism. I chose to draw three roads to heaven, illustrating a page from the chapter on vocations, life callings. The word owes itself to the Latin verb vocare, to call. A series of coincidences, if such exist, had brought that poster across 40-plus years of time and 1,000 miles of space to hang on my office wall. In it, I drew the path of life leading through a field of smudges toward a heaven of puffy clouds. The smudges had been yellow tulips, but Sister Marie Therese, an intelligent woman born to a hard-scrabble rural life and thus one who would know, declared there were no yellow tulips on the road to heaven. As she hovered, rubber-tipped pointer poised to strike at any sign of resistance while I erased them one by one. Where the field ended, I drew two footprints pausing before a question mark. The road forks into three paths, each leading to one of three church-designated callings. The leftmost path leads to the religious life, where I drew a cloud enclosing a cross and a book labeled Divine Office. The middle path leads to marriage, whose cloud encloses a wedding ring, a baby bassinet, and a page from a legal contract. The rightmost path leads to a cloud labeled single, which our catechism offered as a legitimate calling officially on a par with the other two options. I recall an evening spent trying to conceive a visual metaphor for the solitary life. Finally, I settled on a series of musical notes dancing over the caption, Party Time. Well into midlife, what I found most remarkable about that poster is my catechism's teaching that being single was a legitimate vocation, like the religious life, like marriage, a response to a particular and urgent summons from a force greater than individual need or choice, a summons, as you wish, from destiny, from the gods and goddesses, from God, that the growing good of the universe includes, indeed requires, solitaries, as a revolutionary teaching. The Hebrew Bible hasn't much to say on the subject, but the cultural imperative in Judaism to marry and bear children is as strong, possibly stronger, even than in Hinduism. Islam views solitaires as shirkers at best, troublemakers at worst. Buddhism grounds itself in monastic practice, solitaries living in community, but presumes that anyone living outside that community will marry. Another remarkable aspect of that poster, at 12 years old, I already knew which path had chosen me. Father Gettelfinger, even more aged than Sister Marie Therese, asked each student in my class, I was the only one to respond single. Popular culture tells us that even in our postmodern age, being single is party time for people in their teens and 20s. After that, single is a way station until marriage, or between marriages, or a dumping ground designation for those unable to attract a mate, or those who are too picky, or those who are so sexually repressed or ravenous or selfish that they can't submit to the civilizing bonds of a conventional marriage, which is the most healthy option and the most selfless path an individual may follow. Or such was the myth until now. We're in the midst of a demographic revolution whose long-term implications may be as significant as the 20th century's mass migration from the countryside to the city. I speak of the astonishing numbers of people worldwide who are choosing to live alone or who deliberately carve out periods of solitude from otherwise conventionally coupled lives. The evidence is accumulating that when people, especially women, are presented with the opportunity and the means to live alone, many will sacrifice to seize it. That the number of solitaries is growing worldwide is without question, but we have made little acknowledgement and accommodation of that fact. Our housing, healthcare, and urban planning, everything from restaurant design to discount gym memberships to the gargantuan loaves of bread our bakeries turn out, is still based on the ideal of the coupled household, preferably with two children. Of the greatest consequence, the stories we tell ourselves embody fantasies of idealized couples and families, even if in unconventional configurations, instead of the rich and rewarding solitary journeys more and more of us are living out. Some see in this development a sign of social breakdown. I look at this demographic transformation and see not the crumbling of the cornerstone of society, but the potential for more diverse and loving relationships to one another and to our planet. With 7.5 billion plus people on the Earth, surely solitaries, especially those who are childless or who adopt, offer alternative stories worth our attention and support. In my case, early in my 20s, I realized that with many nieces and nephews already born, and more likely to arrive, the planet had no shortage of my particular genetic material. In a world groaning under the weight of too many people, I would undertake the second most selfless act I could imagine. I would remain childless. I would do my best to serve others as a teacher and writer. Perhaps some deep wisdom is manifesting itself in these millions of people seeking, or at least experiencing, solitude. Perhaps solitaries are evidence of an aspect of the human character only now permitted to bloom. If one subscribes to the Western conception of progress, that it is possible to study our past, learn from it, and apply those lessons to build a better future, maybe studying the works and lives of our solitaries is key to reconceiving our understanding of the human family.